إن الحمد لله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا إنه أصدق الكلام كلام الله إنه أصدق الكلام كلام الله إلى حدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة في البدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن الكريم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا وقال الله سبحانه وتعالى أيضا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن اهتدى بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم من المؤمنين رجال صدقوا ما عاهدوا الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه ومنهم من ينتظر وما بدلوا تبديلا صدق الله العظيم وصدق الرسول My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the intention and the knowledge that He is deserving of all praises. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His bounties upon us, that which we see and that which we don't realize. And we send our salam and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best of the creations of Allah, upon his family, his household, his companions, and all those who follow him in righteousness until the end of time. The topic today that I'd like to remind ourselves about is based on the ayat of Quran that I recited just now, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, among the believers are men true to what they promised Allah. Among them is he who has fulfilled his vow to the death, and among them is he who awaits the chance. And they did not alter the terms of their commitment by any alteration. And this is the ayat of Quran that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he read upon seeing the death of one of his beloved companions, upon whom today I would like to base this khutbah on the topic of finding good examples, finding good role models for our lives. This is a Sahaba about whom Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon seeing his death, brought tears to his eyes. And even amongst those who were dead with him, he shown special attention to this Sahaba. And this is none other than Mus'ab ibn Umayr radiallahu anhu. Mus'ab ibn Umayr radiallahu anhu. Now, why is it so important for us to find good examples in our lives? And why am I choosing Mus'ab ibn Umayr radiallahu an as an example today to base this khutbah? It's because recently I was reminded of a saying of Salahuddin al-Ayyubi. the conqueror of Palestine. And he said, if you want to destroy a nation without war, then let immorality become rampant among its youth. Or I'm paraphrasing. And as we look in our society today, for the adults and more so our youth today, the people and the principles which they put as the guidance for their life is taking them away from Islam. It's taking them away from Islam. The thing that becomes more apparent to our youth today and the thing that they're exposed to most more today is not the beautiful examples of the righteous people, acknowledged righteous people throughout the history of Islam from the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until today. No. Today, the thing that they're exposed most to is social media. The thing that they're exposed most to is ignorance. The thing that they're exposed more to are people who want to change, people who want to change what Islam is. And in the process of this becoming something that is very much in front of us, we forget what really Islam is, and more so we forget the people who we're supposed to hold as our role models. It is why today we find Muslims fighting that homosexuality be permissible in Islam. It is why today we find Muslims fighting against zina being haram. It is why Muslims today are fighting, we are the ones fighting against Islam and fighting against the principles of Islam. Why? Because of our lack of understanding of Islam and because of our minds becoming contaminated by ignorance and by people who wish to follow something else rather than Islam. Now before I continue, I would just like to say something. We are living in a society today in which everyone has the freedom to do as they please. Whatever way of life they choose to practice, they have that freedom. And as Muslims, we should not go into the street and ridicule people and insulting people for their way of life. No, that is not Islam. And as we look into the life of Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu, we will see that this was not his way. Rather, what I'm saying here today is that everyone has their freedom of choice to practice what they feel like. However, it doesn't mean that Islam should compromise its rules and values and guidelines to suit our own desires. Because when that happens, then we will be practicing something else that is not Islam. And that is the danger in which we are facing today. So let us look at Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu. Why is he such a great example for us? And I will be very short today. We don't want to be here for a very long time. But the chief points that we would like to point out, first of all, he was from one of the most affluent families of Mecca. He had the characteristics of leadership. He had the characteristics that were respected by all in society, the young and the old. So much so that even as a youth, in his early years, he was respected to be acknowledged among the company of the elders and the leaders of society. His words were listened to with attentiveness and respect because it was valued. This was Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu. He was intelligent. He was smart. He was respectful. He had the best qualities. He wore the best clothes. In a time when people find it difficult, when people were finding it difficult to find enough water to bathe with, you could smell his beautiful fragrance before he even arrived next to you. And you could smell him even when he left. This was a luxury that he lived with. Now, in our society, we might not begin to understand what this is. But let us try thinking 1400 years ago, when we couldn't go on Amazon and buy them, you know, a nice perfume for a very cheap price. Or when we couldn't walk down to a good perfume store, or we could travel easily as we can today. No, this was a time when they had to import. As a matter of fact, they said that he used to wear the perfume imported from Yemen. Right, which became very expensive by the time it reached Mecca, but this was the luxury that he was accustomed to. His mother was one of the most powerful women in Mecca, and she pampered Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu. She loved him. So Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu as he was a young man, an intelligent young man, he heard about this man Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam speaking about something new. So one day he snuck into the house of Al-Arqam ibn Abi Al-Arqam radiyallahu anhu, and he listened to the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. After listening to the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he saw wisdom in them. He saw it as the answer for all the problems of the society. As I said, he was intelligent. He didn't go with the flow, not because he was famous. He didn't do things for people to like him. And that's the first point I would like for us to look at here today. Today, the majority of our youth and our people today, we are more caught up with how famous we are. How much people know us. How much people will listen to us. How much people will come to us. We are so caught up with our image in society that we forget to develop the values within ourselves. But Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu, he wasn't like that. He had it all, but he didn't care about it. So he accepted Islam secretly, as we know at that time. Many people, they didn't like people accepting Islam, so they faced a bit of persecution in the early stages. Eventually, Mus'ab's mother, she found out. I'm not going to get into the details, but she prevented him from going to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it happened, so at that time, the Muslims were migrating to Abyssinia. So he escaped and he went to Abyssinia. Now Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu an, at that point in time, he was the most pampered youth in Mecca. Handsome young man, beautiful skin, excellent, the best of the best of all physical and intellectual characteristics. This was Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu an. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would see Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu, because he returned to Mecca because he missed Rasulullah. Subhanallah, imagine this. He escaped from his home because of Islam, given up everything. And as he was leaving, right? As he was leaving, his family caught him. So his mother said, "Hey, what? I can't be your mother anymore." So he gave that up. As he was leaving, his uncle saw him wearing on his clothing. He said, "Hey, this is from your father. And if you're following a different way from this family, then you can't have that." He gave up his clothing. Subhanallah, the very rags, that is what he left Mecca with. And when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he returned to Mecca to be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw the face of Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu, after that journey across the desert. Now, if none of you have been in the desert, trust me, you don't want to be walking across the desert during the summertime. You don't want that. Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu, he was pampered. He was not accustomed to this. His face became slightly disfigured. He was not this smooth face, very handsome young man anymore. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that touched his heart. This was a youth, a young man, living what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us of in the Quran. Know that this world is one of play and one of beautification. But it is something temporary. Islam reached the heart of Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu, and he had in front of him the best of examples, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he came back and he learned from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was acknowledged and respected so much for his methodology, his tactics in da'wah, and his knowledge of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so much so that when the first people from Medina came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and signed and met Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at Aqaba, what did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did? He sent someone as the first ambassador of Islam to go teach the people in Medina. By the way, there were only 6 of them. Very small number. They came and they accepted Islam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he chose from among his sahabas, from among whom were the likes of Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali and Hamza and all of the famous sahabas radhiyallahu alayhim that we know about. But he chose this young man, Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu, and he sent him to Medina. Did Mus'ab hesitate? No. This became their life. And this is the second point I would like for us to be reminded of today. We choose to be Muslims. No one compelled us to be Muslims. Therefore, As a choice we made to be Muslims, it must also be the choice to follow every single rules and guidelines of this deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And yes, we will make mistakes. Yes, we will commit sins. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, all of the children of Adam are sinners. They make mistakes. But the best of sinners are those who turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance. But what does it mean to make mistakes and follow every guidelines of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? It means that we must acknowledge what is right. As the last week khutbah we hear, Amr bin Ma'roof wa Nahy anil Munkar. We must accept and encourage that which is right and turn away and remove that which is evil. We do not enjoin that which is evil, no. But the flip is what is happening today, the flip side of it. Everyone wants to follow their own desires of what they think Islam should be. A person in the street don't go to the hospital and say to the doctor, "Hear what, doc? I think this is the cure for this disease." No. When the doctor says, "Hear what, take this medicine," we take it. No matter how much we read on Google about this disease. Yet today, subhanAllah, in our practice of deen, when Islam is brought to us by those who are experts in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are ready to argue with our shuyukh. We're ready to argue and even disrespect the people of knowledge. No, this is not the way, my dear brothers and sisters. This is not us wanting to follow Islam. This is us wanting to, us to do the way the people of Zakariya radiallahu alayhi salam did, in which even the knowledgeable people, or those who are acknowledged to be knowledgeable, they change the laws of their religion in order to sue the rulers and the people of society. And that is what made Zakariya alayhi salam different, because he didn't, and that's the way of Islam. So Islam does not compromise for anyone. Islam will never change. True Islam will never change. And we must understand that. And this is what was embodied in the life of Mus'ab ibn Umayr radiallahu anhu. So when he was asked to go to Mecca, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the best of words are those who call to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he went to give da'wah. He went to give da'wah. And how did he do it? Did he go in the streets and start with debates with the leaders of the Christian and the Jewish societies? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ وَلَا أَنَا عَابِدٌ مَا عَبَدْتُمْ وَلَا أَنْتُمْ عَابِدُونَ مَا أَعْبُدُ لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينَ. And the last ayat, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says? That when we say to the first ayat, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ, that, you know, say to the kafirun, the people who disbelieve, لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ, I don't worship that which you worship. And in the end, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says? لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينَ. For you, it is your way, and for me, it is mine, my religion. So Mus'ab ibn Umayr radiallahu anhu, he stayed by a guest home in Medina, and he went and started reciting Quran. He just went and tell people about Islam, from house to house to house. And people who didn't even believe, they came and they heard the words of the Quran, they heard the recitation of Quran. SubhanAllah, he was excellent in his recitation of Quran. There is another example for us. To strive to be excellent in the recitation of Quran. This is not only something for the imam or the shuyukh. This is something that every single Muslim can do. SubhanAllah, we're living in a society where we have teachers begging for people to come to learn Islam. When we were studying, we had to beg for teachers to come and teach us, because we valued our knowledge, and the teachers, they knew that. But alhamdulillah, today we have so much opportunities. So Mus'ab ibn Umar, he went house to house, telling people about Islam, not insulting their religion, not speaking bad about their way of life, but showing what Islam is in words and in action. So people were attracted to this, and they became Muslims. Some of them who weren't Muslims, in one situation, there was a very powerful family, they wanted to come and attack Mus'ab ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, and he was informed of this. When he saw them coming, instead of him getting, you know, his ego getting the better of him, and he decided to what? To show strength? What did he do? He said, come and listen to what I have to say. Very calm. When they listened, they left as Muslims. So much so, he was so effective that in the following year, over 70 people came to make the second pledge of Aqaba with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Mecca. And as we all know, that set the basis for the expansion of Islam and the establishment of the first Islamic state in the history of Islam. Through the works of whom? Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu. We do not hear much of the narrations of Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu. We will not hear many people speaking of his exploits in war. But this is a man that when he died in the Battle of Uhud, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he read this ayat of Quran that I mentioned before, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and among the believers are men true to what they promised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. True to what they promised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he looked at Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu. He looked at his garment in which he was shrouded, and he said, I saw you at Mecca, and there was not a more precious jewel, no more distinguished one than you. And here you are, bareheaded in a garment. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he looked at all of the martyrs in the battlefield, and he said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the Prophet of Allah witnessed that you are martyrs to Allah on the day of resurrection. Then he gathered all of the living companions, and he said, O people, visit them, come to them, and salute them. By Allah, no Muslim will salute them, but that they will salute them in return. And these were the martyrs of Uhud. The battle in which Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu, he was a standard bearer in Islam. That he was carrying the flag of the Muslims. So therefore, he was a prime target in the war. When he died with over 70 cuts on his body. And he died as a youth. This was the man that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw that when they pulled the only garment that he had owned at that time at the point of his death, when they pulled it, it covered his head, but his feet was exposed. But when they pulled it to cover his feet, his head became exposed. So what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did, he ordered the companions cover his head and use leaves to cover his foot. His objective in life wasn't wealth, as many of us today, even many of us who practice our Islam, or we think we're trying to practice our Islam, our primary objective is accumulation of wealth, because that is what we associate with success and comfort. His primary objective was not fame. It was just servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in his life, we see an example of sincerity. And he migrated only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Rasul. And he lived his entire life from the time he accepted Islam until his death in one thing, in the servitude of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my dear brothers and my dear sisters, let us not take examples of people who themselves are lacking greatly in their practice of deen as our examples. Let us not take the kuffar as the people to guide us in our practice of what religion should be. No, that is not the way of a believer. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, once Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were having a discussion, and he brought some pages of the Torah. Some pages of the Torah. What did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? Did he say, hey, let me hear what it says? No, he asked Umar, he said, ya Umar, isn't what I brought to you enough? Why is it that we are going to other scriptures for guidance, how to practice our deen and our understanding of our deen? Our scholars of Islam have spent the last 1400 plus years going through the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, compiling knowledge and understanding from thousands, millions of ulama. Until today, there are people who still go and sacrifice their entire life in order to learn this deen, to teach it to us. So let us go back. Let us look to the lives and the teachings of those who are knowledgeable in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as an example for us. Let us take the prime examples from our history and even the prime examples from our lives today as our example for our life. Because none of us, my dear brothers and sisters, none of us by ourselves do we think we'll achieve Jannah. No. If that was the case, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would never have sent messengers upon messengers to guide people as examples. No. Any scholar will tell you that from the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we must have what is called a murabbi, a guide, a person to help us, a sheikh, a scholar, somebody who is learned in Islam, not somebody who is half learned. Somebody is fully learned in Islam to help us, guide us with our knowledge and our practice of deen. If not, we'll have two extremes, my dear brothers and sisters, and that is what I would like to end my khutbah here today. We'll have two extremes happening. When we have people lacking of knowledge and practice of deen, guiding us and setting the standards for us. One is either we became very extreme in our practice of Islam, which is wrong. Or two, we became very complacent in our practice of Islam, in which we will try to even change Islam to suit us, and that is even worse. So neither of them are good. So therefore, seek the proper examples, the role models for our lives. Follow the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as he's shown us. Follow the way as shown in the life of the Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhim. And follow the way as explained to us and taught to us by us seeking, making effort to seek proper knowledge of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Google is not a teacher. Go to the masajid. Listen to the lectures. Ask questions. Do not argue as students. Ask questions to help us. So that on the day of Qiyamah, we will stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, standing before Him even with all the mistakes that we have made, but with sincerity in our hearts, seeking to be the best servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we saw in the case of Mus'ab ibn Umair radiallahu anhu. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfir Allah li wa lakum wa akhira da'wan alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen, habibina wa nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in, wa nihtada bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin, amma ba'd. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, innaka hamidun majeed. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من عذاب القبر، من عذاب الجهنم، ومن فتنة المحيا وممات، ومن شر فتنة المسيح الدجال. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من البرص والجنون والجذام ومن سيء الأسقام. اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين في كل مكان. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين في اليمن. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين في العراق وفي أفغانستان وفي سوريا وفي بورما وفي كشمير وفي كل مكان. اللهم انصرهم، اللهم اهديهم، اللهم احفظهم يا رب العالمين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمركم بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم واستعينوا يستجب لكم ولذكر الله تعالى أكبر وأقيموا الصلاة.